Hello everyone. This review is going to completely spoil Watch Dogs 2. If you care about that, this review is not for you yet. But I'll be trying to make it worth it anyhow. And since there will be loads of comparisons to Watch Dogs 1, I'm going to slightly spoil a bit of that as well. I made a review of it a couple of years ago, and it's not really worth a spoiler warning. Spoiling Watch Dogs 1 is more of a public service than anything else. Let's quickly recap Watch Dogs 1.
It is probably the loudest and most public plot about a hacker that I've ever seen. CTOS is bloody stupid. Aiden's a fucking technomancer or some shit. Bland yet slimy. And unless Watch Dogs 2 is somehow an Assassin's Creed 2 level of improvement, sod that game as well.
So, is it? Well, kinda, yeah. That was a sort of unfair, impossible to quantify statement. But I did actually enjoy Watch Dogs 2. Whilst I was dying inside at the 15-hour mark of Watch Dogs 1 and had been for a while, I was having fun at double that length of time in 2, and I wrapped it up at 40 hours, still more or less entertained. For a lot of the time it felt like this was at the game's expense, however, you'll understand why as we go along. It's a game that took lessons from the first and made some adjustments that are undoubtedly for the better, but it has overcorrected in some areas. A couple of notes before we start, just some kind of housekeeping. I wanted to hate Watch Dogs 2 the moment I watched a trailer of it. I was actually kind of excited to have a game I could have a cathartic hatred towards again. I despise Watch Dogs 1 to the point that I enjoy hating it, and I wanted to recapture that. In the end, I didn't quite get that, obviously. But I got something kind of similar. Then there is the fact that I actually went and looked into reviews for this game, which isn't incredibly common for me. Not too many, but some during and after the game. A couple of common motifs came up. This game has something to say, and this game is best played completely non-lethal, guns are bad, the stealth gameplay is better, and non-lethality feels more rewarding. And lethality apparently does not fit with the game's tone. The Forbes review reads, "Go non-lethal, it fits the happy-go-lucky tone." And then later, "Get the ability that lets you start gunfights by proxy," which I found hilarious. It's wonderful cognitive dissonance. But okay, to be fair to that reviewer, that was from a place of gameplay. The player in question did not enjoy the gunplay, which is a perfectly understandable point. But still, no lethality, as long as you don't pull the trigger. I myself didn't go completely non-lethal for a few reasons. I wanted to play as many ways as possible so that I could have a more comprehensive view of the game. I did, however, play on realistic difficulty, the hardest setting. And I would call this the best experience. It increases the damage enemies do drastically, makes them spot you far faster, and it also says it makes them better drivers, but I didn't notice that all that much. I played a majority of the missions as such. Non-lethal until cornered. Violence was only a fallback. I did do some levels lethal first, depending on the groups I was up against and my general mood at the time, but lethal first was in the minority. I drew weapons if pressed, if I was cornered and absolutely needed an out. I also decided to eschew quick travel. It's not very realistic. I broke this rule about 4 or 5 times, but to be fair, at least twice it was to escape glitches when I was trapped in shop menus. And also, since I don't have a driver's license and can't drive, I played with a keyboard and mouse and didn't swap to a controller when driving. I felt this was more realistic, at least to my abilities. Watch Dogs 2 takes place 2 years after the first game and moves from Chicago to San Francisco. Seeing as hacktivist group and professional dyers Dedsec versus security system manufacturer and local nonsensical company Blume was the only other ongoing conflict in the world of Watch Dogs, that's now going to be the core focus of the story rather than background detail. We join Marcus Holloway, a man going through a really unfair initiation to join Dedsec. He has to break into a Blume server farm and clear his name from the system after being accused of a crime he didn't commit. This raised his threat profile and meant he was branded a criminal in the eyes of every security camera in the world. It's clear from the off that he wears human clothes, so he's already an improvement over Aiden. We open with a bloody pop culture reference.
Your mission, should you choose to accept it.
And there's this line as the break-in continues.
This is like the secret cow level.
You may have heard that this game is references and memes, and they are not as frequent as you may have been led to believe. They do, however, stick out like a sore thumb. I'm not really a fan of pop culture references generally. I make a few of them and I kind of regret it when I do. These are really obnoxious, however. Each of them do read like a normal line has been tipexed out and replaced with a reference. It didn't even need to be tangential. Don't believe me? Nah, that line won't distract the viewer. And they need to know we watched a movie once.
Did Luke ride on Yoda's back? I think not.
Nah, that's far better. We get ran through the basics of the game, as this is basically a tutorial. The simplistic and rigid yet functional parkour, cover hopping for stealth, melee takedowns, ranged combat and hacking. We're limited to non-lethal options. Even in cutscenes, Marcus is underhanded but does not kill. We cut to the Dedsec crew watching Marcus's progress. Sitara doubts Marcus and tells Josh to time his hacking of a door. And before Josh can even start timing, he's already in. This does a pretty decent job introducing the crew and establishing Marcus's gameplay cred. Each character also gets a line that places their role in Dedsec very handily. Granted, over the course of the introduction, we get introduced to Dedsec about 3 times within the first hour. It's not unjustified, but a little bit dragged out. Still, this is better than Watch Dogs 1, in which the main character is, for some reason, a wimp, and then turns out to be Aiden Pearce, led by a pretentious sod, who also loses his sole trait the next time we see him. This is at least simple, but consistent. Inside the server farm, we're introduced to NetHack. It's Detective Vision, an infinite use wall hack mode that's only discouraged by being ugly. Enemies glow red once tagged, even through walls, and hackables are highlighted. Anyway, this is the main chunk of the tutorial. The game has ran you through the controls, and this is a playground in which to use them. A big vertical stealth arena with a couple of objective points and some patrolling guards. And holy shit, we can actually get spotted and get into a fight. They'll even call in reinforcements. And on this difficulty, the odds are stacked against me. All I have to defend myself with is a DIY flail and a stun gun.
Deal is, he's been hanging around the Dedsec IRC, and he's got cred. Figured we'd give him a test drive.
By having him break into a server farm for a national security firm with armed guards. I guess after the Clara incident, Dedsec wants them rough and ready. So, after hacking a couple of things, we get to the final room and wire puzzles rear their head. Now they're physically mapped to the game world. You may think this is cool, I did at first. We're both wrong. We get on the computer.
What the fuck? Why is my threat so high?
Well, look where you're standing. Marcus wipes himself from it, leaving a new profile in its place so that he can play the online mode. I guess this works because Blume doesn't have rollback features on par with Wikipedia. Before he nips off, he also leaves a backdoor into Blume.
Sorry, Blume. We've got unfinished business.
And with the guards having found the unconscious guys from earlier, well, these ones. Not these ones, that's non-canon. We have to Scarpa. And as I am once again spotted, I make a daring parkour escape down and out the building. I had fun. Marcus is then collected by Wrench. He's the guy that the trailers would lead you to believe is the worst character to ever exist. Surprisingly, he's far less annoying than his LED mask would suggest. Far from even the worst character in this game.
Please allow me to introduce myself.
We're shown a montage of how CTOS has progressed these last couple of years. Nothing that happened in Chicago put a dampener on Blume. They're actually getting more widespread and popular. Wait, what about all the gunfights, murder, exploding gas pipes, an army of mercenaries and thugs exploiting the system, and the citywide blackout, the very thing CTOS was made to stop, said absolutely nobody. I'm going to give this to Ubisoft. When it comes to writing a story, they are the bravest cowards out there. Something doesn't make sense? Just say it happens or works anyway. Speed past it full force. Looks like something has a conclusion? Obfuscate and drag it out into infinity. I'm not as up to date with Ubisoft Free Roamers as I used to be when I made the Watch Dogs 1 review. But I did just finish Syndicate as well, and good god, they are mastering the art of nothing happening. It's like one of those virtual roller coasters that you see at arcades. It's an illusion of moving forwards. It's almost beautiful. The tone of the game has shifted. It's a bit lighter, but I would not say it's gone the way of Saints Row, which is a comparison I have seen. I feel it's closer to the jump from GTA 4 to 5. It still retained the darker themes, but it's bathed them in sunlight. It's an attempt to reflect the times through a very cynical mirror. Have a few incredibly unfunny and on-the-nose gags, like calling Facebook Life Invader and so on. Watch Dogs 2 feels like it wants to be that, but it's written by far more hackneyed writers who are trying to reflect the times by grabbing a bunch of headlines and companies and making missions retelling them. And instead of a cynical mirror, they wrote it after binging some Black Mirror, which is basically the same sodding thing. I will say though, this cutscene does actually bring up how invasive CTOS has gotten and how it affects people. Watch Dogs 2 does actually comment on the reality it's created time and again. It does this well once, it will contradict itself at times, other times it will go groan-inducingly far to the point of coming off as childish, and further still, it will seem to miss some really obvious things. Like Marcus trying to prove he's not a criminal by breaking into a security firm. And with the writing and tone of this game, I have no idea if it's aware of the self-fulfilling prophecy it just opened with. And this motivation only gets funnier if you play the game lethally down the line.
Or have they become freedom's last line of defense?
Speaking of Marcus, he's been dragged to a beach. Dedsec are celebrating his initiation at a party. The group has a nice chat, introductions are made.
Yo, your hot sauce? Yeah, man, I loved your frat house hat. Real talk. Thanks.
This weirdo's wrench.
The needs of the many.
And this Casanova is Horatio.
What's up, brother?
What's up, man?
This is actually a nice scene. Some of the lower key character dialogue is actually quite nice. Marcus is respectful of the group without praising them as hacker gods. Wrench has the dumbest dialogue, but it's not incredibly grating.
So what's the fix?
Sledgehammers and fire. No! Sledgehammers on fire.
Everyone is established nice and naturally, and they're making fast friends. Now, let's have some plot set up.
Hey, show everyone what Blume's up to, man. Show the world that their personal data is being used to rob them of their fucking freedoms. Fuck. I installed a back door, so all we gotta do is walk right through.
Marcus, in a drunken state, declares that they should take the fight to Blume. Didn't this happen at the end of the last game? I guess no one cares about the San Fran Dedsec. Didn't get the memo. The group seems unmoved until Marcus reveals his backdoor. And it's at this point that the group is immediately on board. Blume is going down. Finally. Sometime later, Marcus is even more smashed, and evil Blume man jogs through the scene. The two come face to face, and they seem to recognize each other, but neither acts on it. Marcus because he's drunk, and Blume man because I can't think of a good reason why other than not breaking pace. The next morning, Marcus awakes half-naked and hungover in a stranger's house. We get a nice shot of the San Francisco skyline set to music I genuinely quite like, but YouTube copyright doesn't. Marcus is on his new Dedsec-supplied phone being told to get some new clothes and get to Dedsec HQ.
Damn, walk of shame on my first day.
Okay, I do find it a little charming that we download our map as an app on our phone and that the music is revealed to be diegetic. We have to trek to Dedsec HQ ourselves. I liked this at the time, but I realize in retrospect that this is setting a precedent that I'm not a fan of. Okay, so overall, I really do like this introduction. It's so much better than Watch Dogs 1 in every single way, from gameplay to setting a somewhat accurate summation of its tone to establishing its conflict. It has an easier job by not being a whodunit, but besides that, good job. The gameplay portion of this tutorial is also quicker and freer. We're ran through the controls, then given an arena to test what we've learned that's a decent challenge in and of itself. It's an arena in which you can not only fail, but fail in the same way you'll fail throughout the game, not just the game over for getting spotted. This is nothing that should win an award, but for Ubisoft, it's honestly quite surprising, since it lasts less than an hour, rather than several hours of tedious hand-holding and boring world-building. Fucking black flag. Look, it's not as good as people say it is. It's definitely not as good as Sid Meier's Pirates, and you could just play that instead. Also, the area the game drops you in is clever. San Francisco is actually decently lively, and I actually got a sense of character from the city, and this beachy area filled with people relaxing actually made me quite happy to just wander for a little bit and see the world before I got on with things. So I went and bought some clothes. If only it were that easy. And I had actual clothing options, not just some palette swaps of a really ugly jacket. On the way to Dedsec, I did also notice something. On my mini-map, there was this little red area with a map icon I correctly assumed to be a pick-upable. I assumed this would be a territory to clear out, you know, doing some gang clean-out. So I went on in, I put my toe on the land, and since this is realistic difficulty, they immediately opened fire on me. Can't comment on how realistic this actually is, as I haven't visited San Francisco yet. But yeah, I hit up the violent territory, grabbed the item stored within, and then I set about taking down the gang members within. I hunt them down, and no, this area can't be scrubbed. This gangland is just part of the landscape, housing a collectible to grab however I see fit. In this case, it was research. We'll know what that does later. So, I like that I can't fix this, that it's just a part of the natural environment and just serves to add challenge in a sort of no-go zone that I can avoid or duck into during the online, or maybe during a police chase. I do sort of wish these areas were not marked on the map until I stumbled into them. The pick-upables are logged by proximity. The same could happen here, at least for the gang territories, maybe not the security ones, so that if you don't notice the dodgy-looking bloke shouting at you, you're caught off guard. On this note of territories and things popping up on the map, towers are completely absent from this game. You now discover things on the map by virtue of going there. In a way, this is more insidious, at least to my mindset. If 15 things are smacked on my map all at once, I couldn't give a toss, too rich for my blood. Little morsels of gameplay, however, that's manageable. At least until I miss a couple and it starts piling up. But yeah, overall I'm actually sort of warm on this game so far. Let's get to Dedsec and get this ball rolling. We're gonna need money. Lend me your dollars and I'll free you from your digital masters. When we make it to Dedsec HQ, built into the basement of an old nerd store filled with nerd things you may have heard of, like D20s and modern German board games. The gang has been hard at work since last night, preparing Operation Take Down Blume and a phone app. It's here we get a third introduction to Dedsec, this time to the roles of each member.
Now he's trying to build this big-ass drone.
And Wrench?
Good engineer too, but better at breaking shit apart. And yo, Satara? Sis got skills as an artist and a graphic designer. Without her, Dedsec's walking around without a face or voice.
What about you? What's your superpower?
Tactical coordinator, or cat herder.
In terms of what that means they actually do, Sitara talks, Wrench talks, Horatio talks, Josh talks. With Marcus's backdoor available, the Dedsec app is built to exploit it. People who download the app will lend their processing power to us, and since it's also a research app, any exploits found will be shared on the app. Marcus's job is therefore field agent. Or maybe it's PR? Or maybe it's just FUG, you can read it any which way. We need to drum up attention and get people to download the app. That's the early thrust of the plot. Make waves, get followers, they power the app, and they're essentially experience points. If you've ever heard of folding at home, it's the same principle. But instead of helping with diseases, they're supporting domestic terrorism. It's a good setup for an open world plot regardless. Do what you can to get the people listening. However, it's not an idea that can carry a whole plot. And no fear, since the game will underutilize followers in the plot from here on out anyway. Followers do, however, fix a problem from the first game. There, you would get experience points through kills or stealth takedowns, ghosting areas and such. Killing people summoned more people, however, so there was more experience to go around. Now you get followers for finishing objectives, and your method does not matter. At follower threshold, you get some points to spend on level ups. You can also get some more on the world map, you know, those research things, but I only grabbed a handful and I had more than enough. Also, yes, once you get that follower research app, you find out that more followers can make you a better shot. We also get the Dedsec app, which is the mission select screen, with our long-standing objective, Take Down Blume, sitting there as a reminder. The first mission in this game is to get a side mission. Fucking weird to say, but this is Ubisoft, so I shouldn't be surprised. We go to a couple of places, download some things by looking at them, and then prank a pharmaceutical giant who's overcharging on life-saving medications by tricking him into donating to the people he's screwing over by use of a soundboard we made of his favourite rapper, Bobo Dakes. This scenario sounds kind of familiar. Let's talk about hacking. You may be bored of the narrative, and tying narrative and gameplay together is tricky in this game. Hacking in Watch Dogs 1 was comparatively weak. I even compared it to a toned-down assassin summon from one of the other free roam series they do. Hold down Q and a thing happens. Some old hacks return, albeit with a new system governing things, a couple of them are gone, and the new crop is far better. It's still handled awkwardly, but in an entirely different way. For a start, holding down the hack button, now middle mouse, brings up four options. Typically things like making an object explode, lethally or otherwise, depending on said object. You can make the object attract people, and set it to a proximity mode, and yes, you can combo these two things. And lastly, the object can be temporarily powered down, which, depending on object, doesn't have too much purpose, even in the online mode, but it's a nice idea. Everyone can call for reinforcements now. This does also mean that everyone now has a phone and a comm unit on them, so every single person can be distracted or otherwise hacked. We can also nick cash or refill our hacks by downloading botnets from people. Oh yeah, small change, but this mana bar is far more easily read, so that's a good change. With upgrades, we can also control forklifts, scissor lifts, cranes, and window washer platforms. These open up routes during missions and are needed for a lot of collectibles dotted around the map. The scissor lifts are good fun, acting as movable cover and granting an interesting way to approach some situations. Though at times, well, most times, they're just a slow way to climb buildings. And if you see a building you have to climb, your first port of call is to just start looking for a nearby scissor lift. It's quite a dull puzzle that rears its head time and again. And the forklifts are obviously quite situational, and the window washers are quite dull. We can also hack cars. This isn't quite as precise, but I like the ability to quickly throw cars left and right, bring them to a halt so I can nick them, or send them speeding off. It's far more fun than the returning road hacks. Now each of them are available from the start, with the difference being that you upgrade them into QTEs, which I didn't go for, since now you can just make things like the underground pipes proximity triggered, which is at least somewhat more involved since I have to bait people pursuing me into place. The problem with getting vehicle hacks, however, is that it overrides hacking the driver, so I could no longer speed down the highway, stealing everyone's cash as I go. Marcus calls it the privacy protection tax. Another unlock is the aforementioned gang wars and police APB. These forge evidence on a target to either put out a hit or an APB on them. It lets you start firefights to distract. Definitely fun to watch and can help with stealth, or make it far more difficult and unpredictable. It really depends on how things pan out. As the game goes on, security robots, actual working security cameras, and laser tripwires get added into the mix. Why working security cameras are in the minority is anyone's guess. You see, Marcus is also a sodding technomancer after wiping his profile, so CTOS's response to seeing an unregistered face is to just give up. So, the robots are really non-threatening, and once you get an upgrade, they'll start KOing guards for you, so they're essentially a freebie. The lasers and security cams can also be shut off once you purchase a certain upgrade. This is quite dull to me. The robots are kind of fun, but I do wish we'd instead have the ability to reverse these security systems on the guards, or set off a false alarm to move guards around the map. It wouldn't be the most broken thing in the game, as that award goes to the RC vehicles. The RC car you get for free, it's called the Jumper, and there is a quadcopter costing a good chunk of change. It's not needed for the plot, but is essential for some side quests, collectibles, and making the story even easier. So, these vehicles invalidate hopping from camera to camera. I mean, sure, these drones can get spotted, but that's not really a threat. There are also three mass hacks, distraction, vehicle, and CTOS shutdown, later replaced by blackout. These don't drain from your hack power. Lures and grenades have also been removed, but C4 remains and is joined by stun mines, both of which can, for some reason, be used as lures, and mines, and grenades. On that note, you know what else has been removed? The crafting system. So, how do you get new mass hacks? How do you get new RC cars and mines when they break, as mines often do? Buy them? Pick up fresh ones at Dedsec HQs or certain pickup points? Nope. All of these are on a cooldown timer. I'm not going to be mad because this is unrealistic, but this change is a really awkward one that just leads to a whole bunch of new problems. The hacking overall is better than in 1. It's a bit more involved than the vehicle hacks, the various utility vehicles, RC cars, and forging evidence makes the game feel far more about manipulation. But then there's the other half of what the upgrades do. Upgrading isn't that hard in this game. Just following along and doing some side quests occasionally will leave you with more upgrades than you know what to do with. You unlock many of the actual upgrades first, and then they just get minor knock-on effects. And many of the challenges in this game have been made with solutions in mind. The robots have different patterns than guards. Lasers can be blocked, climbed over, or bypassed with a drone. Cameras force a different route for stealthy characters, and make you risk running into them on the way out if you don't remember where they are. However, I only had to tangle with these the first time I saw them, as the upgrades lead to you just being able to switch them off. I hadn't realized until far too late that I had just become able to turn all the challenge in the game off. It's not as though I switch them off once for 3 seconds, so I have to time myself and wait for an opportune time, and trying to hack them again would lead to someone wising up. I turn them off for a good half a minute, and if they come back on, but fuck you, off you go again. This makes sense in a thematic way. Look, I don't know shit about actual hacking, but then again, neither does Watch Dogs. But I assume a hacker would be far more interested in just removing an obstacle rather than overcoming or subverting it. But gameplay-wise, it's a little flat for an upgrade to just completely destroy a challenge. The level-up system is unchanged from the first game in execution. I've outlined all the interesting upgrades, at least until I get further into RC vehicles. There is a whole tree for just making the mana bar longer, and many upgrades are just incremental bonuses, like smaller cooldowns or making certain hacks more mana bar efficient. It becomes quite dull, and less than halfway through the game, I was having trouble picking upgrades, not because it was between two cool things, but I was bored with all of my options and trying to decide what might be the most interesting. Playing on realistic was a choice I made because of how overpowered Aiden was. I played the first hour on normal difficulty before deciding that due to my criticism of the first game being easy, and feeling that would continue onwards, I needed to move up. I feel this decision really did benefit the game. Marcus is fragile, and there are no health or damage resistance upgrades. Marcus doesn't have bullet time, he may still be competent with anything he picks up, and there are still some upgrades that make guns more effective, but I eschewed them. Save for one, which makes the always equipped stun gun a bit faster to reload. Marcus, even on the same difficulty, is weaker than Aiden, which I am fine with. Combat is discouraged far more effectively this time around, and playing on realistic made the pretty standard firefights far more rewarding and intense. Most enemies die in a couple of hits, but then so do I, and armored foes can genuinely push you back. I never felt like I was killed unfairly, even on this difficulty. It came down to being caught out in the open when I really should have been more careful. The third-person shooting is ultimately once again fine, well animated and it flows well. It now has a free weapon limit, 2 discounting the ever-equipped stun gun, which would be a fallback option if you ever ran out of bullets, which seems impossible as you carry several hundred rounds on you and they seem to refill every 5 minutes. The stun gun is the pacifist option, and it's still a perfectly fine weapon. As for the guns themselves, it's a smaller lineup than what we saw in Watch Dogs 1, but that's mostly just trimming the fat. Pistols, assault rifles, SMGs, shotguns, both pump and automatic, are available, and the gunplay feels perfectly serviceable. Weapons have a nice degree of kick, make a good noise, and enemies go down. There's also a stun grenade launcher to make the fourth non-lethal combat option besides avoidance, melee, and the stun gun. The unique weapons come from the ones that Dedsec prints. Yeah, in case you didn't know, Dedsec has a 3D printer capable of making firearms. It can make AK-47s and such, but Wrench has prepared a bunch of more eclectic firearms for us, which should raise some alarm bells for absolutely everyone but him. Especially Sitara, who cares about Dedsec's image, while Wrench makes a gun with a skull on it. Marcus as well should start thinking about what organization he's joining up with after he prints out his RC car and then notices a complimentary 4 noobs pistol. To call them unique is a bit much, they're mostly standard weapons, just, you know, you can give them paint jobs. Then there's my favorite gun in the game. The dot file rifle is a burst fire assault rifle. Decently powerful, incredibly accurate. Assault rifles in general are just the best things to use in this game for versatility. If I'm going online, I would take this and that one-hit-kill sniper rifle everyone brings, because everyone else brings it. I don't love it for its practicality, however. Oh no, this weapon is so incredibly cruel. It has smart bullets, which hack people on death. D dipping into their bank account or phone and nicking money or energy. That ain't going to the funeral. There are a couple of other guns with properties like... I know another one of the smart rifles reveals nearby enemies upon a kill. I am disappointed there aren't more hacking guns, but I can't think of many other options that aren't incredibly overpowered. Due to the fact that Marcus is far more fragile now, and all enemies can call for reinforcements, and will do ceaselessly instead of just surrendering after one wave, and the fact that police will turn up to gunfights in the more public areas, plus the more open layout of maps with at least two or three routes and opportunities to get flanked, combat feels much more like a last resort, and this is good. It also feels like, to start with, there are less enemies on the maps in this game, but they're individually more dangerous. Basically, realistic difficulty approaches what I thought Watch Dogs 1 should have been. Doesn't quite get there, but it's approaching it. Also, combat means that the police will be on your ass when you leave. CTOS scans have been removed, possibly due to the removal of crafting and therefore jammers would have just been odd on a cooldown. Or maybe it's because CTOS scans were a stupid idea in the first place. The police here instead just turn up to crimes, which is rather novel. Cops can now operate boats. As displayed in the Chip Cheesem LP, police were incapable of chasing you into the waters in the first game, not so anymore. I also can't just escape them by getting on the trains like last time. This won't quite do it. So, the hacks available for chases aren't as powerful, because I didn't upgrade them into just QTEs. Escaping post-combat is therefore a bit more challenging. I had to get out of dodge, get somewhere concealed, and wait it out. It feels odd afterwards, like the cops are psychic and the game is rolling a dice to decide if they check out my alleyway, but besides that, it's fine. I can't really argue that the combat by itself is incredibly hard, however. During one gunfight, I managed to down every enemy with just the basic stun gun and some persistence. They woke up after a while, so I had to change to lethal eventually, but I basically curb stomped them. Due to your ability to see through walls, the enemy's sort of sluggish AI, and Marcus's incredible aim, the game is still sort of straightforward and you have a ton of advantages. But that stun gun thing is more an exception than a rule. It varies from mission to mission. On the other end of the spectrum, we have stealth. I've got to confess that I am bad at stealth, and it's not just because I enjoy shooting things and fighting things up close even more. I am just bad at it. I won't deny that it's its own brand of satisfying to sneak through an area undetected, and it can definitely feel far more skillful and considered. The stealth system has not changed much in and of itself from the first game, it's just more interesting levels that make it more palatable. As I said, open levels with several methods of approach, even in interiors. Typically, you have to collect an access key to open all the doors, or even gain access to the objective. It is, however, incredibly bare bones by itself. A ton of thought went into hacking with very minor changes made for every other facet of gameplay, to the point that very basic things have been overlooked. The two stun guns can incapacitate a guard for several minutes, and melee takedowns put them down indefinitely, but are of course more of a gamble, being much longer and requiring you to get into range with a guard. In combat, the melee animations are picked at random and so lengthy as to be useless. What annoys me is that randomly, a quick split-second punch is one of the random moves. It's kind of funny, but if spotted, I wish Marcus would dial back the flashiness for a second. Still, the stun gun and melee are differentiated well, and obviously have their bonuses and drawbacks to make each of them a viable but different choice. I think the melee is non-lethal, at least one person will die due to this. Plus, there are unique animations for hitting civilians, and even a unique animation for punching people on benches or lying down, so they thought of that. So, why can't I move bodies? This is such a basic thing for stealth, to hide evidence that something's up. Guard routes overlap a ton in this game, so if I take down one guard, I am on a timer. This means that if one goes down, it has to be company nap time. Everyone must go. Is there a term for when a game has over-specialized so much that it forgets that the character has hands? Marcus is so hack-dependent that he forgets he can just physically move bodies. There's no analog methods to mess with the guards, unless you count firing a gun as analog. You can't tap walls or anything. Another thing I hate is that if one guard spots you, all guards are immediately aware of your position, are calling reinforcements, and they've drawn guns. Even if I take down the guard before he can yell. Even if it's a dog. So yeah, CTOS is SOP. Granted, this is combat and stealth on their own. What about when you involve hacking? You can hack in an instant, it's always available. The only problem is the hacking lock-on is a little bit sticky. Besides that, hacking kind of breaks everything. like getting upgrades that exist purely to turn off challenges. The fact that every guard can be distracted extends this to every single enemy in the game besides dogs. You know, at least until the next game where the dogs get headphones or something. See a guard? Text him. He's out for a good 10 seconds. Under fire? Blow out his comms. And bam, he's rendered helpless. And this is the same length of time they're distracted on normal, otherwise the guards would never get off their sodding phones. You can do this to a guard over and over again, infinitely, hack power permitting, and that can be made plentiful very quickly. They never get wary about the constant stream of images getting sent to them and start ignoring their phone, nor do they rip out their malfunctioning comm unit or change frequency to render them unhackable after the first time. You can just switch the guard off again. You have to remember that there's also mass distract on cooldown, so you can hit the switch and sprint through the stage, and you may even clear it before they look up. The infinite reinforcements and quicker deaths do not really stack up against how powerful distraction is. Forget putting down mines, forget rigging the environment to blow, forget luring guards into the places where it's gonna blow, forget hacking cars to run people down or moving forklifts to draw attention. The most powerful hack in the game, bar none, is texting people. And if distraction destroys challenge, then the drones are here to bury it. I'm pretty sure the RC car could dig a grave. It can do the physical hacks that beforehand would require you to be present. The quadcopter can scout, and with upgrades see through walls, the RC car gets a higher jump, and both of them get a speed boost and the ability to drop either kind of bomb. The idea of the RC vehicles is to scout things out, go through vents, and learn the lay of the land. Send an RC car to get something Marcus can't reach, so he can head in and finish up the rest of the job. In practice, the RC vehicles can complete roughly 80% of the game. That's a very rough estimate. The player is only rarely required to expose themselves to any danger, as a minority of objectives actually require Marcus to be present in any fashion. In one case where Marcus needed to be in range of an upper floor laptop being hacked to complete the connection, I just nabbed a nearby scissor lift and stood outside the building, unsure if this was intended considering the stairs. But I was nonetheless satisfied with myself. Now, sure, these things can only be a limited distance from Marcus, but it rarely comes up in objectives as few mission locations are big enough, and due to their open nature, this can just be solved by circling the place a bit, just scoot over. This may just be something that I'll dislike. I still sent Marcus in for a majority of the game as I want a game to have risk and failure. Distraction may be busted, but at least I can be slow on the draw with it or overlook a guard, and guards can down me very quickly if I make a misstep. Let's think back to the fact that RC cars are on cooldown. Even if one is destroyed, I can just send in another shortly after, even quicker if I upgrade its cooldown. So it's not like the RC vehicle is a single shot clearing the mission free of danger. You have as many attempts as you want with them. And by the way, you're not limited other than combat ability. You can still hack and distract with them. If a guard spots an RC car, they will attempt to destroy it, but if distracted, they'll still check their phone, during which time you can get away. Plus, you can recall and instantly redeploy either vehicle with no cooldown, teleporting them back to you at no cost and despawning the old one. I have three examples of times I just decided to see how far I could push the game, and I found it had no pushback. I just utterly broke the stealth. And what I did wasn't even that out there. I broke the game just using the systems and techniques I was provided, mostly as intended. From least to most insane. At one point, Wrench's mask is stolen by the FBI. We got to get into their secure location, leak FBI data, and steal back his mask. So I decided to go loud for our good buddy Spanner. This was no easy task. This is for me the hardest mission in the game to go violent due to how many sightlines there are and how many reinforcements come in. Multiple attacks went poorly. One protracted 20-minute gunfight was successful, but I was killed in the getaway and had to start over. I'll give it to this game, the checkpoints in it are suitably harsh. So I decided to stealth it. I deployed an RC car, and I cleared the stage easy peasy in about 5 minutes. Marcus never even entered the building, he just stood outside as the data flew to him and the RC car pocketed the mask. Another is when we had to blow up rigged voting machines in an old military fort, rigged to vote for a man named Fruss. I sent in a quadcopter and bombed each and every one of them from outside the fort. Again, no risk, I won this on the first attempt in a couple of minutes. I had zero chance of failing as long as I stayed outside. Lastly was in the late game. A robot we'd stolen way back in the beginning of the plot was to be snuck into a TIDUS company repair facility since it was rigged with an EMP. It would be sent to HQ for processing, and then boom, we power down the building from within. I called the police on every single guard in this facility, one by one. They were all arrested, the police never questioned it, and the guards all went willingly without a fight. This won't work on gang members, but law-abiding guards will stand down and bugger off. This was a slow process, but completely possible. Essentially, Watch Dogs 2 has very few calculated risks in its gameplay. Even on realistic difficulty, Marcus's bag is a car and bomb phylactery after a one-time payment. The removal of crafting I'm not against, but cooldowns are a lazy replacement, which just leads to a very different problem. On realistic difficulty, I'd accept smarter guards, actual limited equipment, and not being able to recall cars. You know, so I'm instead tethered to my equipment and have to decide how I use them. Funny enough, the game does have a method of trying to curb your bullshit. A single method, and it barely comes up. If enemies suspect foul play, which mostly takes the form of them seeing vehicle hacks or forklifts acting weird, they can call in for a CTOS reboot, shutting you out for a time. This was incredibly rare in my case, however. I had to be really taking the piss for them to call in for a shutdown. Distraction, blown comms, RC vehicles getting spotted, none of these raise the alarm for a reboot to flush you out of the system. I do remember trailers promising to make any approach possible, from a pacifistic ghost to a running and gunning murderphone.
The player is free to approach the mission in any way he wishes, as a ghost, as an aggressor, or as a trickster who focuses on manipulation and hacking.
A quick spoiler, but Marcus never kills anybody in a cutscene, and at no point during the game are you put in a situation where murder is the only possible solution. Any blood on Marcus's hands at the end of the game is entirely on the player. I think trying to make any approach viable is a nice idea, and while I can see the point of the people arguing guns should have been removed from the game entirely, I also don't agree with them. The gunplay is far less involved than the stealth, and not at all suggested in the cutscenes, but I somehow doubt the stealth would have actually been better if guns were not involved whatsoever. If anything, it may have just made the stealth more frustrating by removing fallback options. The problem is that I feel Ubisoft have no idea how to make stealth options interesting and challenging. Without hacking, what is there is a very simple line-of-sight, cover-based stealth system. No social stealth, like blending into crowds, and very little auditory stealth, save for guards going into alert when there's gunfire. In my playthrough of Syndicate, I realized a very similar approach to encouraging stealth over combat, making majority of the stealth options incredibly overpowered and near all-encompassing. Smoke bombs, for instance, halt all enemies. Even if you're spotted throwing down a bomb in a sprint, enemies won't blindly dash through or attempt to circle the fog. They stop dead and won't pursue you. You get electric bombs later, and the protagonists are immune. Enemies are not. So you can just spam them at your feet and fry all of your enemies. And you can combine this with the smoke. Throwing knives are silent, plentiful, and aiming them has a ton of aim assist. Enemies also investigate dead allies by casually strolling over to them for a nice long inspection. There are poison darts which make enemies violent, and is lethal to the recipient. And the AI has no interesting or specific response to Barry just deciding to violently leave the gang and life. One of the characters can eventually just turn invisible if they crouch and stay still. Meanwhile, the other character gets slightly stronger punches and the combat in Syndicate is dreadfully dull and poorly designed. Why would one button press translate into two punches? It's so fucking disorienting. Watch Dogs 2, meanwhile, gives you a wallhack helicopter, allows you to basically turn off the enemies, and solve problems from two blocks over. It lets you bomb the enemy from on high, set off multiple explosions, and when you move the construction equipment, they may give you a timeout. Meanwhile, combat has no interesting angle to it. You just shoot people, you distract people and then shoot them maybe, or you blow up things around them, and the stealth is so much more fleshed out and efficient and better. It's not equally viable. You know, if you go loud, you'll go up against non-stop reinforcements who come in knowing exactly where you are. I am fine with stealth being favored over gunplay. It makes more sense in the presentation that Marcus should not be winning gunfights with gangs, well-equipped security forces, and occasionally the police. It's just that gameplay-wise, again, it feels like they've overcorrected on the stealth. Hacking is not leverage, it's debug mode. If there is any truth to them saying they wanted all gameplay styles to have fun, it's the removal of the morality bar and followers becoming EXP. You don't get followers for ghosting areas or killing blokes. Dedsec likely doesn't advertise that. you get a set amount of followers for clearing mission segments and a big payoff for finishing the final objective of a mission, and you also get followers for activities and diversions completed. The game does not judge methods, only results. It's sort of funny that a non-lethal run is considered the ideal way to play. This game is made for self-imposed challenges, since you can switch off any challenge you want.
Hello, counselor.
Marcus, to what do I owe the pleasure?
We need to talk, off the record.
I'll meet you down by the water sign, south of my office.
I'm on my...
Hey, I hated Clara's outfit, so how's this? I'd call the early game the hijinks arc. We need followers to take on Blume, so let's get the people listening.
For this, we need perfect sound, we need a big screen, we need to be comfy, we need quiet.
Have you seen it yet?
Nah, man, I waited for you.
You're the best. Thank you.
Our first actual mission of the game begins with the gang watching a trailer to Cyberdriver, which they seem to agree will be entertainingly bad, I think. However, it somehow insinuates that they're script kiddies.
We gotta get these hackers somewhere safe.
They aren't hackers, Devin. They're just script kiddies.
So Dedsec goes on the warpath to prove that they're better than that. This feels really weird the first time you watch it, as they go from enjoying the trailer, and it's not clear they're enjoying it ironically, then they all stand up and decide, well, that studio's fucked. We break onto the set, steal the script, leak a bunch of corporate emails, and then decide we're going to make our own trailer to the movie. Sitara contacts a scumbag journalist who gives us the storage location for the movie car. We nick it, make it remote controllable, and take it on a joyride around San Francisco, filming and uploading the spectacle online to draw in those followers and reveal that Dedsec is just a bunch of fun-loving lads. Scientology at New Dawn have our video taken down on all social media sites, so naturally they're going down next. We can frame it as a righteous crusade as well.
This could be big for us. I mean, nobody's gonna take the side of those assholes unless they're already members.
We are so gonna cornhole this fake-ass church.
I will not be censored!
Well, it's very simple, Sitara. You just contest the strike. I've done it before. What you do is...
...records of their celebrity shills, right? We check out the local center, we just need to get in and dig up his file.
Well, if we're going to be petty and convoluted... Siska is the main actor of the movie, and he's a New Dawnologist, New Dawnist. Whether you're a religion or a tax scheme, please name yourself for easy demonyms. Then we get an over-edited Dedsec video. I have realized something from the first game. CTOS probably was not representing people with skulls, and having a big random feed from their servers to display people's homes. Since skulls and such are Dedsec imagery, I really should have got that. So, I take it back, CTOS. You were evil, but not needlessly showy. No, the actual explanation makes way more sense. You see, Dedsec, the people who are pro-privacy, made an app so that when you hack a server, it picks a random house for you to watch for a bit. Who the fuck wants what in this conflict? Anyway, I hate these videos. They come up mostly after main missions as a sort of Dedsec mission statement. Nonsensical information overload aside, I just question how many months after the events in question these fucking things came out, or what poor editor is being kept in a sub-basement. We turn up outside New Dawn offices. Sitara, our brand manager, has come up with a real catchy chant. Trying to take down New Dawn by secondhand embarrassment. Alright, I'll give it to one graphic designer. That holy shit sign is hilarious. We're gonna break on in there and leak some shit. It's here. This early in the game, I started to realize how bullshit the RC cars are. Plus, you know, that use of scissor lifts. We follow up by pretending to be an auditor and interviewing Jimmy Siska, the lead of Cyberdriver. He talks about rumors of a re-education camp he's concerned about, so off we go.
Oh yeah, man, and one last thing, man. Like, your last five movies have been just disappointing as shit, so act better. Alright, keep your chin up. Peace!
Hey, he teleported over there. More leaking ensues. Marcus says we should call the police. We really should, he's absolutely correct. But Siska says he knows something that could really deal a killer blow to the church. So, let's take all that glory for ourselves and just leave those people back there, I suppose. We break into their church, get into the basement. Shit, 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 shit! And hey, stone tablets, but they're fake. Marcus records himself knocking them over, but he's edited out of the over-edited video. And, yeah, I guess New Dawn is fucked now, because that's the end of the mission. Sometime later, Marcus is helping at Wrench's garage, and the CEO of home security firm... Home, challenges Dedsec on air.
I'll say what you mean, truly. Dedsec. Now, if they want to go up against us, I invite them to try.
What the fuck else do you think is going to happen? The Dedsec lads are off, as it's decided that Home has to die. We steal a prototype home security robot to exploit a zero day, a thing I had to go and learn about. It's some kind of security oversight that won't be fixed until outside forces exploit it. After nicking the robot to the best of my stealthy ability, Dedsec messes around in its head, has some brewskis, Wrench may or may not fuck the robot.
Pat tells Home how to cockblock us.
You've got a weird relationship with technology, you know that, right?
This leads to us breaking into a smart home, and this is the introduction of security robots and lasers, and despite later gripes I will have with both of these, I really like this segment. This game has a problem with variety. Every mission is a B&E, an open-ended B&E. Occasionally you do get a chase afterwards, but it feels like a punishment for getting caught. The open-ended structure does help prevent it from going stale, but for most of the 40-hour journey I was sneaking into a selection of industrial locales and office buildings. There isn't anything in the way of a heavily structured set piece that challenges your abilities in a specific way. Car and camera stealth segments are gone. The plot doesn't force side activities into the fray. A side mission does, however, but missions rarely, if ever, have a unique gimmick to set them apart. So busting into a quiet, home model home staffed by a robot and security features is actually kind of standout. So with an RC car, we sneak in and start downloading data from the home server within. But it turns out to be a relay. The actual data is stored off-site. So we bust into that place too. And whoa, hey, they're spying on everybody, but wasn't Blume already doing this? Anyway, we then nick a satellite and broadcast another video whilst the home CEO is giving another interview on national television. He's a busy boy. Cut to the CEO of Home and Blume Man. Neither are very happy. Blume Man tells Home to stay away from Dedsec as he'll take care of them.
Don't go near Dedsec. They're my responsibility. All you need to do is figure out an apology to my lawyers for laying your hands on me.
And with that, another victory for the millennials. Okay. So, what happens next is what I'd call the end of the first arc of Watch Dogs 2. As we're driving, Josh messages us, telling us to hurry back to HQ as some bad shit is going down. This will not be the last time we get a message of this urgency during the plot. I'm on my way. Back at HQ, there's a panic. It turns out that a ton of our followers were fake accounts. We were being watched all along. We find that the source of the fake followers came from inside the Invite office. Invite being Facebook or LinkedIn, I don't fucking know. We head to the suspiciously empty lot and break into the CEO's office. Marcus is greeted with his reinstated CTOS profile, and all the bots disappear.
What did you do?
Nothing, this isn't me.
In walks a man in a tracksuit. He saunters into the room with a man who may have a kill count in the tens, if not hundreds, and starts pouring whiskey.
I don't really need to introduce myself, do I?
I know who you are.
Well, I don't. Please introduce us, you impolite fuck. Okay, Evil Blume Man's name is Dushan Nemec. Yes, they do point out that you can easily call him a douche with a name like that. It's why the writer named him that. Like I said, I watched the trailers, and I think that was expected of people playing this game.
All of it controlled by one man, Blume CTO, Dushan Nemec.
Wait, so all these companies...
How this expects you to watch those things and then buy the game, unless you're as stupid as I am, is another matter. I did not know his name until more than 50% in. In that time, we have had various little scenes with Dushan, and this is his big villain moment. Not a good time to be fishing around in your memory to get a name. The only reason I picked up that this guy was Dushan was because characters started casually tossing his name around and I worked it out from context.
Guys, and knowing him, his dick probably has its own fucking man bun on it.
Anyway, this is the big twist moment that's meant to raise the stakes and make us rethink how we see the plot moving forwards. But it's really the moment the plot smashes its head into the ceiling and never really stops stumbling. Dushan has been engineering situations in which Dedsec would attack companies, such as Home, and I have to guess the movie company, so that Dushan could wander in and sell them on installing CTOS after they've been hacked, and therefore we've actually been playing to his tune all along. We hacked all of those companies by exploiting CTOS, right? I mean, it all uses the same interface. We're kicked out with CTOS reboot. Now, I get that this is a gameplay thing, but this is what CTOS looked like in the first game, and it's consistent here. Plus, besides any of that, aren't whole cities built on CTOS infrastructure now? What the fuck is going on? This isn't even a big ruse. I'm pretty sure any digital security consultant or white hat hacker in this setting could take one look at what's going on and say that CTOS is not doing shit for anyone. Plus, we're leaking things non-stop, and Dedsec are back at HQ, always listening in on Marcus. Would this not be a monumental scoop that the CTO of Blume is admitting to underhanded tactics where he sicks hackers on companies to coerce them into his security network? I hate to use the old just record the villains argument, but exposing corporate types for shady dealings is your MO, and this guy is your biggest target, he's your endgame. On top of all of this, couldn't Dedsec just come out and publicly demonstrate that CTOS 2.0 is already an open door? This doesn't even take effort. You could unravel this web of bullshit with a single tweet and a vine of Marcus blowing up some underground steam pipes.
A few fucking civilian casualties is the cost you have to pay for the betterment of the world.
Yeah, that sentence would go down well. Anyway, Manbun points out that there's a warrant out for our arrest, and then leaves the room without any difficulty. I will say, the cutscenes do match up best with a pacifistic Marcus. I've killed people for far less. Marcus escapes the cops, collects Dedsec, and flees for Burning Man. Swelter-skelter. Dedsec is feeling down, feeling like they should disband. They've been labelled criminals and script kiddies and they were just made chumps of. Marcus is undeterred, however. He needs to prove he's not a criminal, and he'll steal, leak, and hack everything not nailed down in the pursuit of that goal. So he enters them into a hacking contest. It's a fucking wire puzzle. Okay, I put off talking about the wire puzzles, but really there isn't much to say about them. They're back and they're out and out worse now. Them being physically bound to the world isn't used to make them any more complex or interesting, just more dragged out. They never add much to the game and they just feel like padding. They're never used during a stealth segment, whilst under fire, or while driving at speed. That would require an actual set piece. They're sectioned off to mostly safe areas and are just used as a catch-all hacking solution. I remember one scenario where a new spin was put on the wire puzzles. We're up against a rival group of hackers, we have to solve the puzzle against the clock as we're in a bunker that's set to explode. The leader of the group spins and resets segments of the puzzle, once per segment, and then gives up. You know, I do wonder if security companies get to make their own wire puzzles or if Blume does it for them. You have to pay per node, does that increase the price? Swelter Skelter itself is a sort of experimental open ground for all the comedic dialogue in the game.
My entry is called! Ah! What the fuck are you doing? You ruin everything! You ruin me! You ruin! Ah!
I listen to all of these.
Say something random.
Okay, beer is oil for the human machine.
Blomp.
Oh, damn! You just inception bombed me!
Blomp.
It's dreadful. Humanity's it's well and truly dreadful, but it's also the only part like this. I mean, in just walking around, talking to folks, you actually get to talk to your Dedsec mates and get their feelings on things. The game could have actually done with more segments like these, but I'm also kind of glad it didn't because what's on display here is...
I had toes. I stared at them, and they disappeared.
Ugh.
Back when I used to do sets. Hey, maybe I'll go back to it. What else am I gonna do now?
Anyway, after Dedsec wins the hacking competition, Raymond Kenny arrives to get them high.
You're not Ray. You're Ray, Raymond Kenny Ray. I still got your old hacker zines, man.
Him and Marcus hit it off, Ray seeing his group as talented but aimless, with no hope of going up against Blume. And tells them that the real enemy isn't CTOS, but Bellwether. Okay, I'm not quite clear on the differences between the two. Bellwether's getting fed information and it's kind of automated, but whatever, Marcus is interested. The next morning, it turns out that Ray slept with some biker gang member's girl, so Marcus and co. flee back to San Francisco. That very moment, a night after fleeing from the city, with an even bigger terrorist.
A stranger into our house.
Look, it just happened, all right? We were running from these bikers, right? And look, you know what? It doesn't even matter. He's cool.
Oh, he's cool. Well, that's good. Because we usually discuss these things as a group.
I know. It's my bad. But you met Ray already, right? I want to introduce you to Raymond Kinney.
Can I have a hug?
Dedsec decides to take Ray in. He's a legend in their circles, after all. They'll occasionally throw drama at Ray for the rest of the game for absolutely no real reason or payoff. They just accuse him of being untrustworthy or unscrupulous at points.
How much do you trust Ray?
Look, I don't want you using Marcus as your personal weapon against Blume.
Wait a minute. How is that any different from how anyone else is treating Marcus? He does all the fucking work, and he's taken it all upon himself willingly. Yeah, Ray is actually sort of surplus to requirement after he introduces Bellwether, and his inclusion only really leads to empty drama. Well, I guess now that we're finally back in scenic San Francisco, let's talk about what we can do here. I'm going to point out, first of all, I actually do like the map of San Francisco. The city is far more interesting in layout, the game managed to give it a sense of identity and character. I had fun exploring back alleys, finding lovely little garden areas, scaling the rooftops and riding through the hills on the outskirts of the more urban areas. The different parts of the city felt far more distinct and lent themselves to more interesting exploration and gameplay. The increased focus on rooftop exploration and parkour gave the city a degree of verticality I didn't get much of in Chicago, even if the climbing and parkour is incredibly scripted and uninvolved. As for diversions, well, it's mostly just racing now. There are random co-op events that are occasionally dropped in on you, like chasing down a random hacker or doing a control point mission. But aside from that, several flavors of racing, kart racing, bike and drone time trials, it's not terribly exciting. The kart racing was oddly hard, however, and it's probably my favorite of the racing diversions. I did most of it in a side quest that makes you do the races, in between stealing carts to upgrade your cart so you can beat some rich university kids that you never get to see. Gotta nab the pot. Huh. I guess coming back from the dead will net you some followers. The collectibles on the map are probably my favorite change in this game. They're little miniature challenges, or at times just lying around for some reason. These collectibles are money. Collectible cash was my primary source of income. Research points, which are a solitary point to spend on a level up. Key data, a collectible required to even access certain level ups. And then there are collectible clothes, paint jobs, and cars. These little challenges do lend some depth to corners of the world. And this is where the RC vehicles really do feel like their own thing rather than the scourge of San Fran. Granted, a good number of collectibles require certain level ups to even access and are basically gated behind unlocking them. This is also true for some side missions. You are not 100% in the game without the quadcopter. Tons of cash bags require you to have control of scissor lifts. Not a tall order, but it means a lot of puzzle solutions are to just look for the nearest scissor lift and slowly ride it over and up. I do appreciate the open world does mean that on occasion I can bypass or brute force puzzles, so this sort of evens out. Then there's Scout X, a phone app where you can take selfies at a bunch of San Francisco landmarks and Ubisoft. It's a bit of virtual tourism that I did enjoy. It only really feeds into itself, unlocking new gestures as you go to more landmarks. I spent a good hour roaming around and had a good time. Keeping on with driving, Driver San Francisco is the cutesy name given over to the Uber application, reminding you that Driver died again so that Aiden Pearce may live. These are taxi missions and they're an okay diversion since the driving this time isn't awful. Holding down W accelerates like any other game now, rather than turning up the speed of the car. You can also unlock a boost power-up that applies to any vehicle you get into, which makes travel a bit faster overall, and also really fucks up those kart races. The driving isn't standout, it's generically arcadey. I only really have one problem with it, and it's decidedly minor. Aerial leaning has been implemented. When you hit air, you can use WASD to influence the car for flips and turning. Guess which button I'll be holding down whenever I leave a ramp or approach the ground. Throw in some dull and occasionally wonky physics, and getting air in this game isn't all that fantastic. Luckily, the amount of lean is so weak that this problem mostly corrects itself. So, I do feel the need to reiterate going forwards that I did end up liking Watch Dogs 2, but I enjoy breaking it down so much because there's a ton of missed opportunities, it's very weirdly written, which I'll be getting much more into, and I also ended up liking this game in the same way that I enjoyed Warlogs, realizing that I could willingly break it at any moment. There are three online modes. Online co-op with a host of exclusive missions, online hacking returns, and is joined by online bounties. Okay, so. The game also touts seamless drop-in, where you occasionally see other players about the world. I didn't mind it, found it both charming and sort of immersion-shattering, just like the constant button prompts. Well, okay, those weren't charming, but Watch Dogs 2 just kind of accepts its artifice and celebrates it. The co-op missions are pretty straightforward, and aren't too much more challenging than what's in the single player. The only new difficulty is trying to coordinate with me. Online hacking I really enjoyed, both as invader and victim. I enjoyed it in the last game. Once again, however, the RC vehicles are running the show. My instant response to getting invaded was to throw up the quadcopter and start combing the area, since you can tag the hacker with it to just win the invasion. And I won near every invasion as invader if the other player did not have or refused to use their drone.
Can't cheat me out.
The only real countermeasure is trying to shoot the drone out of the sky, which is a gamble in and of itself since, you know, you're trying to hide. The invader's drone does work against them at least, you can ping their drone to get a line pointing in their direction. This is an intended feature, so it means keeping tabs on your target is incredibly risky. Granted, getting caught is at least enjoyable. I like that it encourages escaping rather than killing your enemy, and it's quite rewarding to outmaneuver a player. The game does try and do a good job of putting you into the other player's session in secret when you're invading them. You're dropped a good while away and get to decide on an opportune time to strike. While this can't really be fixed, I only got caught off guard a couple of times. It becomes clear there's an invader in your game whenever you check the map or go to pause the game, and it doesn't actually pause. This also halts you from entering missions, where the game just has to admit that, yeah, you're getting invaded. Cheeky sod, I'm trying to progress. Here, come and try and hack me. Yeah, thought so. I'll point out now that you can opt out of either online mode. Online bounty is a fascinating idea and occasionally works out very well. At 3 stars, other players start getting called in to assist the police, which as escalation goes is pretty hefty. In many cases I'd join a bounty only for the quarry to get taken out by another player or the police before I could even get in range. In one case a player had gotten into a near untouchable position before calling in for his bounty. You do risk wasting your time. When it all comes together, however, I've had really fun and interesting chases and gunfights. In one case, I kept sending out RC cars with bombs attached to them to draw sniper fire away from me and distract the enemy so I could line up a shot. I had one of the best car chases I've ever had in a game in this mode. Hacking other players' cars to send them careening into walls and hacking and counter-hacking steam pipes led to an intense back and forth where both me and my opponent were waiting for an opportune moment to destroy the other player's vehicle and land a killer blow. The chases are about positioning and driving skill, and they're really fun. The hacking kind of comes into its own in this place. Either way, that is basically it. The online is my favorite part of the game. Both competitive modes have a good number of flaws, but make up for it by being fun. I do appreciate that the online doesn't restrict abilities. The game could get away with restricting bounty hunters to certain guns and hacks, powering them down since they get to work in a group. No dice, however, just bring in that one-hit kill sniper rifle. The guy you're invading likely has one as well. Either way, that's pretty much it for free roam. Digital trips, drinking, and chess is gone. The only real diversions are everything I've listed. There are shops for clothes and cars, pawn shops to drop off things Marcus steals from cars, and cash bags for a tiny bit of extra cash, which is a really superfluous feature and I didn't make much extra dosh in doing so. There are the gun printers at HQ, and cafes and bars which let you look at an animation. I feel these cafes could have been made online lobby areas for that seamless drop-in, where you and several other players could stand around selfieing or something. Then there are side missions, and the side missions are side missions. They're not cookie-cutter camps, towers to climb, or taking out a nameless gangbanger. The game uses side missions, and indeed Driver San Francisco, to expand on CTOS and tell little mini-stories. This is a near entirely good change, but something about them does lead to more prodding and guessing. The side missions run a spectrum in terms of length and complexity. Some are just cutscenes, little more involved than the privacy invasions from Watch Dogs 1. You watch something and maybe intervene with a hack, like the world's slowest QuickTime event. After the mission where we take on Home, we get a call from Sitara revealing a pedo amongst their ranks. We watch a cutscene and then someone back at base calls the police. We have the option of frying his hard drives through a camera while, once again, someone back at base records him.
Jesus, I am so fucked. I'll see you there.
Okay, I'm leaving now. Oh, and Grizz? Cash.
Then we follow up by humiliating the Home CEO further. It's a bit of a tonal shift. Some side missions you do get as part of story progress. Most of them you get by hacking phones or talking to people in the world. I do find it funny that you invade people's privacy to stop them from getting their privacy invaded in a lot of cases. Anyway, some are cutscenes, others are as long as main missions, if not longer. In fact, my favourite mission in the game is a side mission, and it's incredibly in-depth, had large implications for the setting, possibly actually did more for the world than most main missions, it has a bunch of cutscenes, a darker tone all of its own, and ends with one of those stupid fucking videos. The reason I went into great depth about the hijinks arc earlier is because I needed to at least point out the mission structure of this game. Missions are incredibly segmented. You go to a place, do an objective, and then drive a couple of kilometers to do another objective. It could be sneaking into a base. It could be a bloody wire puzzle. It could just be hacking one guy's phone for some dialogue. You do it, get back in your car, and go to the next place. I complained about that one mission in Watch Dogs 1 that started you a good while away from your actual objective. That is the majority of missions here. Granted, you can now quick travel to any shop or HQ on the map, so it's a drive or a quick travel. I eschewed quick travel for this review, if you'll remember. A couple of side missions are actually just little activities, but handled really awkwardly by virtue of being presented as missions. Like when Dedsec discovers an ATM exploit. This unlocks about 8 cutscenes all around the map, where you hear someone's story and decide whether to give them money or screw them over somehow. I have a choice you make. This is really awful.
Guan, how can I assist you today?
How about you contribute to the bake sale for sport equipment?
For 1,000th customer, you've won $1,000 cash.
What? I can't believe it! Carol, this thing gave me $1,000.
What am I?
No. This is a me fund. A me fund, Carol. Never mind, I gotta go. I feel the need for a babysitter coming on.
It also displays some Black Mirror-level empty cynicism. Thing is, those 8 cutscenes, one of them is unlocked at a time rather than all of them at once. They don't lead into each other, there's no arc here, and it's not like you can just pop in and do the nearest one if you feel like it. They're just really awkwardly handled. Sitara's painting side mission is sort of the same. About 9 things need to be defaced in total, but they're given in chunks of 3. It ends in a finale where we ride very slow lifts up the Golden Gate Bridge. Really slow, this is more a test of patience than skill. Sometimes the pacing feels like really weird padding or just an oversight. In one main mission, we have to ride a crane to go and talk to Wrench, after which we have to slowly ride that same crane to a different roof. The cutscene is the two of them talking about freeing people from manipulation, a talk we've had a good few times, and it could have just been handled during gameplay while we ride the crane up. One side mission has us go and hack company phones, trying to find an access code. We hack one and... oh dear, the guy was just fired. This is so that Marcus and Wrench can take the piss out of Sitara for making us go and hack the wrong phone first. Now, I realise this is ultra nitpicky, the other guy isn't even that far away. But this only happens in service of a really unfunny joke. I'm going to indulge and nitpick further since it's that unfunny. Sitara doesn't have a character trait where she feeds you bad information. It's the exact opposite. In the plot, she's always the one who has contacts and knows who to ask for what. This joke disappears after the side mission is done. Watch Dogs 1 was written by one bloke. It was stupid, but only in a number of ways possible by one person. Its plot also felt like it wanted to be one flowing narrative. Watch Dogs 2 has 8 writers. I don't know who wrote what. I've only ever written screenplays and never wrote in a crew. I can't say how much this did affect Watch Dogs 2. I am, however, going to say that Watch Dogs 2 feels like it was written by 8 people. 8 people who were told sort of similar, but sort of different things about the game, and were not allowed to read each other's work, making them worried about stepping on other people's toes. Madlin! This is a story about a group of lovable, happy-go-lucky revolutionaries sticking it to the man. Man. Ethan, Watch Dogs 2. It's going to be about a group of hypocritical, petty domestic terrorists doing whatever needs to be done to bring down big security. Ah, Jared. Here's a room full of movies, comic books, and a computer hooked up to 9GAG. Just get in there! Right, and after a week we'll let you out. Just vomit everything you've consumed onto the other scripts, but don't read them.
Aliens versus Predator.
The question doesn't make any sense. I mean, aliens...
Ah, Kevin. Fuck off. The missions are incredibly episodic and self-contained. Each mission another group comes up and messes with DedSec or just pisses them off, hitting a hornet's nest with a baseball bat before deciding to sit still and see what happens. And DedSec goes on the offensive, finds out that this group is corrupt, and then they leak it. The gang is then surprised and even has the brass balls to be insulted several times throughout the plot when they're branded as criminals.
Oh shit.
What?
It's FBI. You hacked into the FBI.
First it's Blume, then the FBI, and it culminates with Marcus being put on Homeland Security's Most Wanted just before the finale. The actual plot is basically, hey, fuck you, Blume, and Blume Man Dushan is occasionally mad in a cutscene afterwards, except when he's not. But every mission and most side missions, a company or group is introduced and disposed of, and it has a very awkward momentum. How far away from Blume are we in the pecking order? At which point do we have the followers to take on Blume? Hey, Horatio works at Noodle, they're on Bloom's side. They share data and feed it to Bellwether. So let's infiltrate them.
Smoothies. Now that's where it's at. Load them up with fruit, veg, superfoods.
Superfoods?
Yeah, like goji berries, maca powder, all that good stuff. You have a lot to learn.
Silicon Valley hipsters! Boom, and done. Hey, rival hacker group Primate have put a lock on our server after getting paid off by Bloom Man. And if we don't make a video mocking ourselves, our identities will be leaked.
But if you don't do it, then I start naming names.
That's right.
Names! Identities! A veritable who's who, bitch.
Let's destroy their business deal with bikers and raid their headquarters to remove the lock instead.
Donut hole!
Look at that! Seems like I handled the booms.
Not fucking over.
Yeah, it is.
Right now. And check this one out. Someone's spying on us from right outside.
Hey. Motherfucker.
FBI is now onto us.
I'm not doing anything.
On the ground, now.
I'm just walking my cat.
Wrench is captured, and it turns out Blume Man is pulling their strings. He frees Wrench. We get Wrench's mask back. Emotional scene. Plus, FBI and Blume are no longer in cahoots because we leaked something, I guess.
I'm not gonna let him do that. Look, he's got the FBI on speed dial and he's gonna come after us hard, so I need all of you.
A local Mexican cartel, from nowhere, kidnaps and kills Horatio. This mission is given to us at the same time the FBI is onto us. Couldn't it have been them or Blume who did it? Not just some random cartel guys?
Fuck!
Why'd they film it too? Who filmed this? Why'd they leave it there? Did they want Marcus to find it? What's the plan? This is dumb. So let's kill or smack the guys who did it. Yeah, that'll teach you.
That's for Horatio, bitch.
I'll blow up some of your cocaine too. Bye bye, Horatio. Galilei is launching Blume satellites, so guess what? DedSec's going into space. And this leads into the final three missions before the big finale. Galilei also had my favourite bit of stealth in the game, actually. If riding this big heavy crane to each of my objectives isn't stealthy, then I don't know what is. And no, that whole thing about leaking our identities, that threat that was made, that might come up in a side mission afterwards, but no, the group just kind of ignores that threat and is like, fuck you, Primate. It's really weird. The game feels like the main mission line was cobbled together from a bunch of side mission ideas. That long-term plan, take down Blume, and early game focus on getting followers, makes me think that at first, there was only going to be really a handful of big missions available when you get to certain follower thresholds, letting you tackle any side mission you wanted up until that point in any order, and basically deciding what you wanted to take on. The idea of followers loses all focus pretty quickly and they just become experience, and by the end of the game it's a footnote. I mentioned my favorite mission in the game was a side mission, and that is 911. It's an hour long, making it one of the longer missions. It has several fully fleshed out encounters, and a unique gimmick that runs through each, where Josh creates a mosaic, basically letting us anticipate enemy positions and set an ambush for them. This doesn't appear anywhere else, making it the one unique gimmick the game has. We follow a police scandal where several corrupt cops are abusing CTOS to create dead zones, areas too dangerous for cops to tread. They then go to these areas to do shady deals with gangs. We disrupt the operation, even taking an ambulance with a dead gang member's corpse in it, and leaving it in front of the FBI building. They use the ambulance for a distraction or something. It culminates in us escaping from Alcatraz. We arrive there, about to set up our ambush, when the deal starts early and we're caught off guard. We escape and leak the news. The police can abuse CTOS. The video even points out that not all cops are guilty of this, which is weirdly even-handed compared to everything else in this game. It has a ton of dialogue, cutscenes, and ends with one of those terrible Dedsec videos. And like I said, what happened here should really have major ramifications for this world. It's the best mission in the game for both story and gameplay. Its events are never referenced again, like most missions. The FBI are going to be hitting us hard? Bullshit. Lenny has our data. Did the writer learn Lenny wasn't coming back into the actual plot and sneak its resolution into a side mission? We punch a cartel leader in the face and he backs down, or just realizes we're not worth it. Then again, we might kill him and it would be awkward if he came back then, wouldn't it?
So, Marcus, I'd be remiss if I didn't point out that a young man who discovers that the Federal Bureau of Investigation is after him should probably re-examine some of his life choices.
Good advice.
Particularly a young black man.
Guilty.
Watch Dogs 2 style segue. Some of the characters are likable, but most of them are genuinely terrible people. The thing is, I do like Marcus's character, and the Dedsec gang do have some nice moments together. I buy their friendship. The game does also have 3 minutes of the least enjoyable dialogue I've ever heard.
I could see a Predator Spearmaster keeping two away with a Yelcha combo stick, but a third Xeno is gonna be able to get in close. Even if he kills it, that blood splash is gonna melt right through him. Has taken on Archie.
Shit, you're right. Archie's basically the top of the food chain.
And a lot more where that came from. Regardless, the crew is likable. Josh could have easily come off as annoying if mishandled, but he's instead kind of endearing.
Because that's programming. That's rewriting over old data. That means you lose who you were.
I then do sort of feel sorry for him ending up aiding someone like Marcus. Wrench proves himself a good mate to Marcus, and the reason he wears a mask starts making a good degree of sense in the setting. He's not just wearing it because Ubisoft thinks it's cool. It's because he's got some shit going on, least of all being shy. Sitara stakes a lot of pride in her art and the cause. A big part of her character seems to be that she just wants to make a statement. But she's not above making jokes. And Horatio died. Marcus, however, I could believe Marcus having a life away from Dedsec had he never been screwed over. He's one of the few video game protagonists I can imagine having friends that aren't just his mates because, hey, fuck the bad guys. He's friendly, takes genuine interest in other people and their interest.
Johnny Five has never been on his own before.
Johnny Five? You have good taste in movies.
Able to make jokes about himself and up for a good time, and does come off as well-intentioned. One of my favorite bits of dialogue in the game comes from one of the taxi missions. The passenger starts drilling Marcus about how driver is screwing over career taxi drivers. Marcus brushes it off in a believably self-interested way. He doesn't want to hurt taxi drivers, but he also wants to make a buck. Let's ignore the cash just lying around. Contrast this with when a secretary is bad-mouthing Dedsec. Since a mission we'd cleared earlier in the plot, wait, shit, callback to something that happened, that's unusual, made her job harder since her boss is freaking the fuck out. The game acknowledges here that Dedsec's actions are also harming workaday people who aren't trying to fuck everyone over. Marcus comes off as spiteful and bitter that she doesn't appreciate Dedsec, making her life harder in the name of progress. The game does occasionally have news pop-ups that do sort of imply that, hey, Dedsec isn't all that good, but it feels so shallow, and it never leads to anything.
Can't see the people you're stepping on.
Well, you don't much like seeing it either. Still, I can buy this bit of hypocrisy. So let's contrast even further. After the New Dawn mission, it's revealed that thanks to our leaks, other Dedsec sectors have started firebombing New Dawn churches. Marcus brushes it off completely as though they're completely blameless. Doesn't even tell Josh that they should, you know, put out a missive that they should knock it off. Regardless of how you feel about Scientology, and I'm not exactly pro, this is fucked up. The universe bends to make Dedsec look good in spite of everything. Rival hackers Primate, which, by the way, fuck that name. They're represented by Lenny. She was brought off by Dushan to attack us. She has to be a petulant, obnoxious twat. No one sane would oppose Dedsec. No, they have to be slimy or corrupt. And she doesn't like Dedsec because they're so self-righteous do-gooders, they're so whiny. She's just into hacking to turn a tidy profit. Dushan paying her off would be just enough motivation, but she's also childish and temperamental and she turns it into a personal grudge. It's really lucky that everyone in this game that opposes us turns out to be corrupt if the game forgot to introduce them as such. There's a side mission where someone claiming to be Dedsec is swatting streamers. Sounds bad, right? Not the swatting thing, no.
This is only gonna hurt our image.
Claiming to be Dedsec.
Who is this tool?
Basement troll, amateur swatter, internet garbage.
This is gonna be fun, but not for him.
So we swat them.
Nobody likes swatters.
Good moral lesson. Real good moral lesson. Sitara is worried about her cousin streaming online, so Marcus and Sitara decide to scare her straight. I was expecting this mission to be really uncomfortable, and to be fair, it still is a little uncomfortable. What they do is more than a little messed up. Hey, you're vulnerable if you're streaming online, so I had to call one of my mates to go and hack you explicitly. I mean, I'm gonna take this moral lesson to the logical extreme. I also shot someone outside their house, so she'll be scared to leave. Just sit inside and read, don't do anything. During the noodle mission, Horatio is trying to lend mission support, but is interrupted by an arsehole co-worker who suspects him of being Dedsec and is trying to get management on him. We halt our infiltration of the noodle servers to switch some files across computers, implicating arsehole co-worker instead.
You know, you could just tell us what you've been up to. Where you've been looking, who you've been talking
to. Get a coffee.
What was that?
Just trying to get a coffee.
The only reason this character is a dick is because if he wasn't, it'd be even more obvious that he's not in the wrong whatsoever and we just ruined his life. The game does this sort of thing semi-regularly and it always comes off as strange. At times it's trying to portray the protagonists as dubious people, and at others it wants you to feel really gosh darn cool for sticking it to the man. And every time something wacky happens, I just have this weird thought, man, Aiden Pearce exists in this world.
You know that?
Looks like Pearce really got himself into a jam.
Don't just tell us about it, help him!
And then we save him from an underground bunker and everyone at Dedsec gushes about how cool he is.
Tag team with Aiden Pearce.
You're kidding me.
Nah, it was definitely him. The Fox.
Did you get a picture?
No.
What? Okay, besides anything else about how wrong this scene is, the characters panic as though, oh god, Aiden Pearce might die. Didn't Pearce fuck Dedsec over pretty hard at the end of the last game? You people have ruined lives for far less than what he did to you. But no, Aiden Pearce is an urban legend. He's the vigilante. He's basically treated like a superhero. And then we unlock his clothes. I wore them for special occasions. It made me really good at the online hacking since I'd never want to be seen in this. Talking about Aiden Pearce, another side mission springs to mind. It's one of those that's just a cutscene. There is a random house you can hack into, for no real reason, and it brings up a feed of the guy living there killing himself. You can hack objects in the garage to create a racket, alerting his neighbor and saving his life. We just used the system we're deathly opposed to save someone's life. It wasn't the wrong thing to do, but it sticks out like a sore thumb. None of the other characters comment on it. It just comes and goes. That's the kind of ultimate feeling I have about this game. It has a lot of words, but only occasionally says anything. And you can bet your ass that somewhere in there, it will also say the opposite. So when something like this comes along, I wonder if it's just accidental or really understated. Anyhow, why did we get followers for this? I guess we put up the video of us saving him. I'm in no way saying that a game has to 100% commit to a tone start to finish, but from moment to moment, mission to mission, it's all over the place. Playing the side missions did not help whatsoever, and just made recalling the actual plot even harder, since they can have just as much weight and gravitas as the main missions, it's just they tended to have one break-in rather than several in a row. Playing the game with side missions turned the tone, pacing, and intentions of the characters into a weird mush where I don't know if the game had any consistency. Anything to actually say. Okay, so there was only one consistency, and that's that Dedsec has been designated as good and everyone else evil until proven evil. I have no clue if the main characters are well-intentioned twats or genuinely good people who happen to do terrible things. I could list more examples, but even I think this is going on way too long. I want this review to come out within my lifetime, so let's get to Blume and the finale. After hacking into space and jumping around the globe to get into Blume's central server, we're downloading everything. How are we going to store this? We reveal three final missions. Invite is allied with Blume, and they're pushing for the election of a guy called Fruss using their platform. So we go and reverse that, leak the politicking, and blow up some voting booths. Robotics company Tidus is making Spiderbot a fucking reality after some virtual crackhead talked about it. And the implication is that this will be used for quelling riots, so it will be used on civilians. Yes, a fucking spider tank. Lastly, the Triad have access to the stock market, and via hacking, are insider trading. Blume handed them access to this. Want to know why? It's the best part of the game. I know I've said that about three things now, but this really is it. This is comedy gold.
2007? Wait, you saying the financial crisis was...
an early bellwether test.
Blume, via an early test of bellwether, is responsible for the 2007-2008 financial crisis. They then handed the details to the Triad, so if it ever got out, they have plausible deniability. CTOS is used so insurance companies can investigate their clients and jack their rates. It's being used in an urban gentrification scheme to price old tenants out. And lest we forget from several seconds ago, Dushan is tied to voting fraud. The game is pushing Blume as evil so hard, and I have to ask, why? A villain doesn't become more evil because he has more sticky notes of his evil deeds attached to him. Blume has already won, as of the opening cutscene, just by doing their job of being a security firm. The country is buying into their security scheme in droves, and they're installed nationwide. They were already evil in the context of this story because they are invasive and far too large for their own good. Comedy is subjective. I think this game has about two intentionally funny lines throughout, hidden under a pile of pop culture references. But Blume. Blume is the funniest joke in this game.
He's a robot. I want you to get us caffeine. He'll take a decaf.
See, that line was kind of funny. But no. We need one mission where there's a spider tank they're helping to create. We don't even get a boss fight with Spider Tank, we control it for a bit and it's worse than it was in a hallucination, but then I guess that makes sense. Dushan is also a really boring villain. I can only figure out one possible reason he may exist, and it's a really hollow one. I noticed a similar feeling in Syndicate as well. Both games rush to make you hate their respective villains, but it doesn't give them an interesting angle, or make them particularly intimidating. And in the case of Dushan, when you find out his real intention, everything he does makes less sense. Both Syndicate Starrick and Dogs Dushan aren't really people. They're personifications of their group. Starrick is a high-ranking Templar. Sorry, he's the high-ranking Templar. He has a bunch of business in London, and we dismantle those businesses while he makes no earnest attempt to recover his losses or inhibit the heroes. He exists to be killed at the end so it feels like progress happened, even though in the actual ongoing narrative, nothing really happened. Manbun here is the CTO of Blume. He made a lot of extra dosh out of shady dealings. Somehow more than he'd already need running Blume. I buy greed as a motivation, but he doesn't seem all that interested in protecting his secrets. When Wrench is captured and the FBI are trying to turn him into a plant, Dushan walks in and forces them to let him go, wholly aware Marcus is watching in.
What am I gonna do with you, Marcus?
The answer is nothing. The writers on the next few missions don't know this scene exists, and you're just a face for me to hate. Dushan doesn't really act against you. Every loss he takes, he just takes. He's here to get fucked over at the end of the plot, since it's easier to show one man getting screwed over than show any tangible effect of your campaign against Blume. Marcus and Dedsec becoming more and more wanted over the course of the campaign is also really hollow in both plot and in-game. After we have our CTOS profile reinstated, that's the perfect excuse for security cameras to actually be a threat, but no. As the game went on, the city could have changed, more security checkpoints, security cameras and such around the city so you could feel a security state coming to form that you're rebelling against. The rising follower count could have led to more graffiti and defaced security features. In the final mission, Marcus is stuck at HQ since he's most wanted. Sitara and Wrench go out and do some legwork so that he can hit Blume HQ. Sitara does a really bad wire puzzle on a random rooftop, revealing Mary Catskill, CEO of Invite, has been manipulating events all along. So I guess we can have a sequel hook here. Wrench hits a Blume backup server violently. Wrench is suddenly an actual badass. The one other confrontation he's had in the game, he was an utter pansy. I don't think I'd want more sections like this, but I felt like they added a little to nothing. Marcus usurped all responsibility. Ray is hit the worst by this. He tells us about Bellwether, and then everything he does after that, any other member of Dedsec could have done. He just invites aimless drama and stands around.
I'm gonna go for another beer.
We attack Blume headquarters while the rest of Dedsec causes confusion. A bunch of people are running around in Marcus masks or something. Time to wrap this up. This will teach them for calling me a criminal. I never cyber stole anything. Take that, Blume. How's this for my threat level, you fucking savages? I think I was a little unfair on CTOS in the first game. Not because if you think about it, it actually makes sense. It doesn't. It's just that CTOS was there as convenience. It explains why our hacking works. It's all under the same banner. It's a backdrop for a revenge flick. Now CTOS is a primary plot concern, and Bellwether too, whatever it actually is. Rather than actually making sense, however, a light has just been shined on it. And it's exactly as backwards as the first game would lead you to believe.
Something that maybe only a few may have noticed. But when the financial crisis hit in 2008, Blume made cash.
As did other companies. What's your point? Oh, in hacking into Blume's servers back when we were in space, we cause a power cut to the entirety of South Korea. Ray calls us out on this, telling us we need to be careful with blackouts. The blackout he caused, leading to several deaths, led to him helping out on CTOS back in 2003. Anyway, then he helps us build an EMP to plunge Tidus headquarters, a robotics factory, into darkness. Smaller scale, sure, but he had no qualms about that. So in the end, we bust into Blume to leak all of their data. Again, didn't we hit their central server? I guess they keep the juiciest deets in their own basement. I escape the ensuing police blockade by mass distracting and sprinting away for the finish. Yep, I guess that's where Dushan kept all the incriminating stuff. Marcus and Ray confront him.
I've been elbow deep in Ray Kenny's head, massaging his code, improving it, overriding it, but I gotta give you some props, though. You had chops for someone that was clicking two rocks together.
Or maybe it's your lawyer telling you there's no place to run. Maybe it's just a telemarketer. You really should answer it this time.
Whoever...
And they stand watching as the police swoop in to arrest him. We have a montage of Dedsec celebrating their victory. Marcus makes a video celebrating the movement and hacking.
Invited you to join us, and you did. You said with one voice, we will not be lied to.
And a news report reveals Dushan's sketchy maneuvering using CTOS, which I don't feel he did enough to defend. After the credits, we're dumped back into San Francisco. Sometime earlier. That final mission really is underwhelming. Not a rooftop raid overlooking San Francisco, or some great underground base. Or even some dumb confrontation on a landmark like the Golden Gate Bridge, where we fistfight Dushan off it or something. It was just a big basement, under an office. Then we beat it and we get sometime earlier. the finale just kind of fizzles out. And that's why I hate Dushan, aside from being dull. He's arrested to create a feeling of climax. The game kneecaps itself, since it can't really show us hurting CTOS. But a corrupt idiot executive? By all means, we can dispose of this character. It feels like it's trying to pull a magic trick on us. Hey, look at this CTOS disappear, and then fucking Dushan is thrown in our face. I don't know how magic tricks work, okay? Then we go sometime earlier, and there's no feeling of closure. Same old San Francisco. I won something I didn't care about by the end, and then don't even get to see the fruits of my labor. That's the end of a 37-hour adventure, however. And the road there was undeniably enjoyable. I feel comfortable recommending Watch Dogs 2. Maybe once it goes a bit cheaper. At first, the gameplay is a surprising jump forwards, despite still being pretty generic. And as it went on, I started enjoying how utterly I'd broken it. The online multiplayer is unique and works rather well. The free roam map actually had some decent locales, exploration, and character. At first, I was ready to call Ubisoft cowards for the tonal shift, particularly during the hijinks arc. I was waiting for it. Knowing it was a self-indulgent thing to say, knowing the game actually handles itself better by being light-hearted. But I wanted to call them cowards for not sticking to Aiden Pearce's rough, dark guns. As it went on, the game became a hilarious, floundering mess, at its funniest when it wanted to be taken seriously, and at times painful when it wanted to be funny or endearing. I'm TehSnakerer, and that was way too many words on a surprisingly okay game. I do have a Patreon. If you want to support these videos, please do pledge. You'll be thanked at the end of videos like the lovely people coming up, and you can get access to my notes, scripts, and a follow-up video where I answer viewer questions about the game and throw in any lingering thoughts. My patrons are the wonderful Playway, Eric Nace, DBZ King, Sigurd, Catherine Garraway, Charles Nelson or Tomascus, and Armin Reddy. Thanks to you all, and thank you everyone for watching.